Hi, welcome to this video where we're going to look at some of the practicalities about sharing your data. The first thing you're going to need is a repository. That is really an online space that's dedicated to the sharing and long-term preservation of research outputs, including publications and other things, but most importantly for us today, data. It's different sharing data in a repository compared to any other website or a journal website, because repositories are dedicated to this function and therefore add some elements that you might not find elsewhere. For example, they will give your dataset a digital object identifier, or DOI. This is a code which specifically identifies your output and it is permanent, unlike a URL. It's similar to what you can get for journal articles, for example, before you have a volume number or page number. Repositories also have machine-readable metadata. That means that anybody who's searching for datasets on the web, according to certain criteria, can find yours, and also that your dataset will be indexed on things like Google, Google Scholar, and so on. And most importantly for us today, a repository will give free access to anyone on the internet and to the dataset that you want to share. They won't collect user data for people trying to access your dataset, they won't ask for money, so it truly is an open way of sharing. I should note that it is possible in a lot of repositories to set some restrictions on the data if you don't want to share them quite so openly. So they will be preserved, but the repository might vet people who've asked for access, or they might require them to get in touch and sign waivers on how they're going to use the data. So that's up to you. The first question you might have is, well, how do I choose one? There are quite a lot of repositories out there. Your first port of call should be a subject-specific repository. This is somewhere that is usually fairly well known in your field. You might have heard colleagues sharing data there. You might have used data from the repository yourself. If you're not quite sure, you can look at a list on read3data.org, which can be filtered by disciplines, and that could give you some ideas to start researching. However, in some disciplines, there just isn't a typical repository. And if that's the case for you, then your second port of call is an institutional repository. If you're at Cambridge, we have Apollo, which is managed by us at Cambridge University Libraries, and it is effectively an extension of our library collection. So you will be required to put things like PhD theses and papers on Apollo, but you can also use it for your data sets, and our team is very happy to help with that. Once you've left Cambridge, or if you are in an institution that doesn't have a repository, then you can use a general purpose one like Dryad, Zenodo, Figshare, or others. These are not discipline specific, they are open to all, but they offer the same guarantees and trustworthiness as the others I've mentioned. One thing that we don't recommend is that you share your data only as supplementary material on a journal article, for example. That's because publishers don't have quite the same guarantees in terms of long-term preservation, and it might be a little bit more difficult to have metadata that's in a common standard. You should be aware that there will be a cost to sharing your data this way. In the case of Apollo, if your dataset is smaller than 20 gigabytes, then you can upload it for free, but for anything bigger, there is a one-off charge of £4 per gigabyte. Zenodo is currently free as of August 2021, but only for those that don't have ready access to another data center. And Dryad charges a basic fee and then surcharges for larger data sets. It's worth investigating this early on in your project so that you can include charges for repository storage as part of your grant proposal. If they weren't included in your grant and it's too late to add them in, then there may be other funds you can access. It's worth having a look around. If you're really stuck and you are a Cambridge researcher, then please get in touch with us and we'll try and help as best we can. It is really important that you describe your data. So we often talk about this as metadata. Basically, at the most essential, fundamental level, you should include a text file with your data set that tells anybody who comes along what the data set is about, how they can use it, gives them the information that puts that data into context so that it can be used more widely than just your project. So Start with the author's name, contact details, yours and maybe your supervisor's. Try to make sure these will be contact details that last in time. So it might not be a good idea to use your Cambridge email address if your contract is coming to an end in the next few years. You also need all the context for the data: how, where, when was it collected, what was the purpose of the project. You might also want to include something about limitations or assumptions that underlie that data. Anything that you think would be important for people to know when they look at it. And a few practical things. So if you are using numbers, what are the units? Have you used any abbreviations in the column headings? Are there codes that you used in a transcript? Anything that's not immediately obvious from the data itself. And you'll want to include links, for example, if you've got some code, more on that later, or any publications that have resulted from the data and used the data. You can also go back and add these links in afterwards if the publications arise at a later date. You'll also want to describe the relationships between files. For example, say there is a spreadsheet that gives detail of the images and then a whole load of image files that are named in a certain way. You need to explain that so that people can orient themselves in the data set as soon as they jump in. And you'll want to include any instructions that people need to actually open and use the data. For example, do they need to download particular software? While we're on that, it's good to use non-proprietary data formats wherever possible. Sometimes instruments require you to use a particular format, and that's absolutely fine. But if you have the choice, for example, for a text file, you should use a text format rather than a Word document format. That way, somebody doesn't have to purchase the Windows software to open it. Likewise, comma delimited files are better than Excel files, JPEG files are better than Adobe files, and so on. I mentioned earlier that you should be sharing links to any code you've used. It's really a good idea to invest the time and use code to process your data, but also to analyze it. So say that you're having to tidy up outliers, calculate averages, and then do some statistics on a data set, or say that you're having to search for particular word frequencies and so on in a text file. If you can use code, that will make your research more reproducible. You should annotate that code, making sure that people who find it can understand what the different parts of your code do, and share it somewhere like GitHub or similar. That means that anybody who comes along can immediately see each step that you took, what the result was, and if they want to, they can reproduce your analysis. This adds an extra level of accountability, transparency, and ultimately trustworthiness to your research. If it all sounds a little bit complicated, then don't worry, there is training available at Cambridge. The Bioinformatics Training Facility offer courses on this, and the Social Sciences Research Methods Centre and Digital Humanities do too. So have a look and talk to your supervisor or colleagues to see if there's anything that might be useful for you. You should also license your data to make sure that people know what they can do with it and set any conditions for reuse that you think would be useful. For example, if you have code, you might want not only for people to attribute it to you, but say, notify you of any bugs that they find that might be useful. If you have something like a simple data set, Creative Commons licenses might be the best option for you. And again, you can use the different elements to create the license that works best for your data set. Attribution is fairly standard, so that people who reuse your data have to cite you as the author of that data set. But some people choose to use a non-commercial element, for example, which says that people cannot make money from reusing your data set. We recommend that you use a license as open as possible to maximize the potential for reuse, but of course, those decisions are up to you to make. And the big question then is, how will your data be used? What are you doing all this for? Well, the first step is you should cite the data in your paper. Remember, you'll have a DOI, a digital object identifier, from your repository, so that should be easy to do. And also, with all that metadata that repositories are providing, the data will be indexed by Google, it will be searchable, so people will find out about it, and you might promote it through social media or blogs or conferences or whichever way you promote your research. That means that people will download it and hopefully find it useful and cite it. And of course, all those metrics add to the recognition that you receive as a researcher for creating and sharing that data set. Cambridge has signed DORA, the San Francisco Declaration on Research Assessment, as have many other institutions. And one of the ideas there is that a broader range of outputs than just journal articles and books are recognized as successful indicators of research quality. So you should be talking about your shared data sets in CVs and grant applications. And if you have a data set that's been downloaded and cited a lot of times, you can use that to boost your profile. But perhaps most importantly of all, other people will reuse the data in ways you could never have imagined and come up with new discoveries, advance your field. And from this collaboration of data creators, data sharers, data reusers, then there can be a whole load of new developments in the pipeline. I hope you found this video useful. If you have any questions, then please don't hesitate to get in touch. Our website is data.cam.ac.uk and the email info@data.cam.ac.uk. We'll be happy to answer any further questions that you have.